This is Tuesday, November 22nd, 2016. We are at the Edith North Rogers Veterans Medical Center in Bedford, Massachusetts, and this tape is part of the Morse Institute Library's continuing Veterans Oral History Project in cooperation with Natick Pegasus. My name is Maureen Sullivan, and we are privileged to have with us today William McCarthy. Welcome, Bill.
Thank you.
When were you born?
4/6/46.
And where were you born?
Basically Lexington.
And what community do you currently live in?
Right here at the Bedford VA.
And your marital status?
Divorced.
Any children?
None.
So tell us a little bit about life in Lexington growing up.
I enjoyed it. It was a very historical community because that's where the shot heard around the world was on April 19, 1775. And it had an excellent school system, excellent. I was well versed in history. In fact, to be honest, I never got above a D in math. I never got below an A in history. And I took every history course, honors, you know, advanced, everything.
And when did you graduate?
1964 is when I graduated.
Now, you were growing up during the height of the Cold War and Vietnam was getting on people's minds. What were your experiences with that?
Well, as a kid, we had to duck under the desk and everything in school. If they dropped an atomic bomb, it would not have been very practical. Lexington had high quality instructors, and I was a history buff. I mean, like the commander of Lexington Minutemen was a guy named John Parker. Captain John Parker. The British officer who reported about him said the Minutemen in Lexington were led by a giant. John Parker was 6 feet tall. The average male at that time was about 5'4". So to them, he was a giant.
And Bill, what do your parents do for a living?
They're both deceased now. Mm-hmm. My father was head accountant for the New England Telephone Telegraph Company, and my mother was basically a homemaker. Mm-hmm.
Did your father serve in the military?
He served in the Army.
World War II?
No, he during World War II, I believe was near Reed Warden. It was before that he served.
Okay. And when and where did you enter the military?
I entered on August 21st, 1968. Mm-hmm. And my recruiter was a Waltham, because there are no Marine recruiters at Lexington, unfortunately. And that's the day I entered.
All right, so you graduated in 1964 and you joined the Marines in 1968. What were you doing in those 4 years?
I graduated from Northeastern with a BS in law enforcement. And I went basically nights to Northeastern, worked days as a private detective.
No kidding.
Yeah.
What was that like?
I loved it. Mm-hmm. And even now, though I'm an attorney, I was an arson expert and taught arson investigation in Northeastern. And as a professor, and go all over New England, and court certified expert in all six New England states, New York, New Jersey.
Wow. What made you go into the Marines in 68?
Well, I was very much for the war. I didn't like the protesters. And I'm not one of these people that says something, doesn't do something. I decided to join the best. And in my opinion, they are the best. Marines have never surrendered under a Marine commander. That's important. We don't take a step backwards. When they were told to leave the chosen reservoir in Korea after the, what they call the Great Bug Out, there are 185,000 Allied troops, 5,000 Marines. Day after the Chinese came across the Yalu River, 180,000 had fled. 5,000 Marines stayed behind. The Marines then were ordered to the sea. The Marine General says, we're not surrounded. The little bastards won't get away this time because they're all around them. Then he said, hell, we're not retreating. We're just advancing in a different direction. And you gotta love things like that.
And well, as we'll finish the story, did the Marines get out?
Yeah, but they had the Chinese are on each hilltop all the way down. There's only one road out. They made it. And their commanding general led them on foot. Ambushes everywhere. I said, I got to join an outfit like that.
Mm. So let's get back to you in 1968. Did family or friends join the service when you
no.
did? Okay, and where were you sent for basic?
Paris Island, South Carolina.
And tell us about basic in South Carolina.
Okay, it was hot. Very hot. Very tough. About 50% of the class flunked out. I had to do a lot of physical things, including the walk for life. We go upside down on a rope, about 180 yards. And that it wasn't fun, but I did it. And we had a lot of tough things. Discipline was extreme. You had to call the DIs sir, because they're teaching you for later when you saw a lot of officers, sir. I had a case that happened to me that was kind of funny. They had sand fleas that were famous at Paris Island, and one of them bit me on the side of the face. I had my food tray in front of my face. So I said, well, I'll hold it with the right hand, hit it with the left hand. Well, the DI saw me hit it. There are three DIs for every unit. He said, McCarthy, I don't think you got him. Whap, right in the jaw. Then he said, McCarthy, what was type of flea was it? I said, sand flea. He said, male or female? Then quickly I said, male. Well, there's a dead one down there. There are a thousand dead ones. But it's female. So tonight, we're going to go out looking for the male sand flea. And we did. The whole company did.
Aside from hunting male sand fleas, did you receive any advanced or specialized training?
Yes. Well, we went from Paris Island after graduating to Camp Lejeune, North Carolina, where I went for advanced infantry training. After my AIT, that's what we call it, I went to Camp Pendleton, California for commando training. In other words, specialty training. The whole time I was in, where I had 4 years of college, they wanted me to become an officer. The reason I didn't is my father had cancer. I didn't want to leave him for the number of years. So I enlisted for 2 years. On my Well, we'll talk about what happened in Vietnam concerning that when we get to it.
Okay. Tell us a little more about commando training.
Oh, you had the slide for life again. We went up and down the little hills, the big hills, at Camp Pendleton. And, you know, I had things like, how do you call in distance? How do you read a map? How do you do a plotting? Everything like that. And hand-to-hand. Hand-to-hand, hand-to-hand, hand-to-hand. And even today, in my somewhat crippled state, I'd still take anybody on with my left hand, left foot.
And did you also learn camouflage?
Oh, yeah. Hell, I could lay down the field, you wouldn't see me.
Indeed. And all along, did you know that you were going to be sent to Vietnam?
Without a doubt. Mm-hmm. When you join the Marine Corps and you take a 2-year enlistment, they tell you. They say, you know, the Navy has 130 different jobs you could do. The Army has about 100. The Air Force has around 200. Marine Corps, you have two choices, M14 rifle or M16 rifle. That kind of tells you what you're going to be doing.
And which rifle did you get?
Well, in training, I had an M14, and in Nam, I had an M16, but I was also a machine gunner, so I fired the M60.
And can you tell us a little more about the two rifles?
Yeah, the M14 was heavier, M16 was lighter. M14, you could make a good shot. M16, could fire a lot more rapidly.
So when did you finish at Camp Pendleton? Are we still in 1968?
Yeah. Well, I would say late November. And the reason I say that is we went from Pendleton to, in December we left. Went from Pendleton to 3 days in Okinawa. The reason we went to Okinawa was to get our shots for the jungle and malaria and everything. And what they did was they had a gun, Navy corpsman. You go up, bing, next, bing, and about 6 needles at once go in your arm. And it had an interesting experience. Guy in front of me was about 6'4". They gave him his shots, and he fainted right on me. He just went backwards, right on me. It was amazing.
And this was a fellow Marine.
Yeah.
Was a ping and fainted right onto you. Okay. Now, you're also about to head to Vietnam in November 68. Was this before or after the presidential election?
Would have been after.
Okay, so Nixon has just been elected. Any thoughts about that time?
Yeah, we felt that we'd have a better shot with Nixon.
Okay. And now, when were you, so you're in Okinawa in November.
No, by then it was late December.
Okay, now it's late December, okay.
And spent 3 days there.
Mm-hmm.
And I took a picture that if I didn't leave my camera in Vietnam, I think would have won a prize. Outside the main gate of Camp Anderson, I believe was the name, there was that. We had to go in from the airport, military airport, Air Force airport, through back roads to get to the camp. The reason why is there are about 10,000 Okinawans protesting in front, throwing rocks, and they want the Marines out of there. Mm-hmm. right across from the enlisted men's club. I climbed on the roof to see the protesters, and we had MPs and everything. We could not leave the base. One way would he go? The people were here looking for blood. Right in front of us, there was a brothel. There were five Okinawan girls, stark naked, holding a sign across their stomachs, "We love Marines, come on in." While their parents are protesting us, throwing rocks down below, and their daughters are raped. They're unbelievable.
Free enterprise. 3 days in Okinawa. Tell us what happened next.
Then we took a plane to Vietnam. And we landed at Da Nang, which at the time was the busiest airport in the world. Da Nang had that record during the Vietnam War. Then they looked at my papers, said, "You're going to a unit that's at the very front of the front lines. You're going to Hotel 24, the Magnificent Bastards. That's the name of our unit." And our Pats says, "I have one in my room, Magnificent Bastards." So I knew I'd be seeing a lot of action. My first day in country, I went from Da Nang to a operation base called Stud, which was for helicopters and troops. It's called, the proper name was the Endergriff Combat Base. And it's, if you see the map, it's way north. And I spent about 3 days there getting acclimated to the hills over there and mountains. And we were attacked 2 or 3 nights. So I actually saw some action there, not much. And then we went to, I'm trying to think of the name. Well, they flew me out to 2-4 on top of a mountain. Helicopter landed. That was my introduction to Vietnam, because my first night there, now I was given an M16. I'd only fired an M14 before, including back of the rear. The M16, under the flares going off in the sky, I look in the M16, this is God's honest truth, says, "Made by Mattel." The plastic on M16, the cover, was made by Mattel Toy Company. I said to my officer in charge, my CEO, I said, "These things really work? They're made by Mattel." He said, "That's just the plastic, God. The rest works great." And then that night, we saw planes strafing the hill, the mountain right across from us. I mean, right across from us. And you saw burning North Vietnamese troops running up and down the mountain. It, for a first day of combat, real combat, you know. But again, I was 22 by the time I went in, a college graduate.
Okay, Bill, let's take a half step back. What was your unit? Were you 3rd Marine, 4th Marine?
3rd Marines, mm-hmm. Hotel 2nd Battalion, 4th Marines. Okay. See, that's 2-4. 1-4 would be Abel, Baker, Charlie, Delta. 2-4 goes Golf Hotel, you know, Fox Golf Hotel. Echo.
Okay. And
But still 3rd Marine Division.
Mm-hmm.
But we're the 2nd Battalion of the 4th Regiment.
And during your first days in Vietnam, what was the weather like?
It was hot, hot, hot.
And what kind of clothing were you provided with?
Well, unfortunately, not Bermuda shorts. Just regular camouflage gear. Camouflage boots, even.
And aside from your M16, what other weapons did you carry?
I carried a Colt 45 because I was a machine gunner. And I carried, 1 out of 3 days, I carried the M60 machine gun, along with my rifle and my pistol.
And yours. And what were you eating during that time?
Sea rations.
And tell us a little more about sea rations.
Sea rations were made basically in World War II. And there were some that weren't bad. Boneless turkey, for example, could do it. They had little crackers they would put with. I was like lima beans, forget it. I was allergic to eggs even then, so anything that had eggs, I didn't have to eat, and I wouldn't eat. But we never cooked anything. We had sea rations. That was basically it.
And what did you do for water?
If there was a stream or waterfall, we put our canteen senders. On the Benhai River in the middle of DMZ, you used to get water out there, and the enemy would be firing at us. It was unbelievable. We had to wait until night to get the water.
So you're in the thick of it right off the bat. Tell us what happened.
Well, the enemy tried to make it up our hill, but yeah, mountain top. But most of them were burnt. See, it's hard to explain to somebody from New England. But the mountains in Vietnam are real close to tops. So we could see them. They're only maybe 500 yards away. But then they went down the mountain, came up at it. We had laid Constantina wire. Do you know where that is?
I've heard of it.
It's barbed wire with razor blades. Circular. Like if you go by a prison, you'll see it. We had trip flares. We had all types of mines out there, and they push a button and explode a distance. We threw a lot of grenades. In fact, where I played semi-pro baseball, and in both an outfielder and a pitcher, I loved throwing grenades. I used to carry maybe 20, 30 grenades in a green sack. I could throw them. The enemy didn't have the arm I had.
And the enemy was all around you.
Oh yeah, they were everywhere. And again, I can truthfully say, now I like Oriental girls, I did a Chinese girl. My friends say, how were the Vietnamese girls? I never saw a Vietnamese civilian, male or female. Where the DMZ is about 30 miles from the nearest village, Quang Tri, and Dong Hai's down there too. We're on the middle of nowhere. We never worried about Viet Cong because Viet Cong were civilians fighting for the enemy. there were no civilians at all where we were. We didn't have to worry about them, obviously. But the North Vietnamese coming across the border, they outnumbered us times, 100 to 1, 200 to 1. You know, we had a couple of times we spotted divisions coming across. Division is a lot larger than a company. Company's 120 guys. North Vietnamese division was about 5,000.
And while you were in training, what did your superiors, what did your drill instructors tell you about the North Vietnamese?
That they were very cruel. They wanted to take over South Vietnam for communism. And we were fighting communism.
And how often were you engaging with the enemy?
Out of a 7-day period, maybe 6, sometimes 7. You have to understand, we're outnumbered. The enemy's coming across the DMZ, which is the most misnamed place in the world. It wasn't demilitarized at all. There were thousands of our Vietnamese.
And how long were you stationed in that particular area?
My whole tour until I got shot. About 6 months.
Okay. So tell us about what happened.
Well, we were on a patrol. And the interesting thing about it was going to be my last patrol for a while. Reason why was I was company scout. So I used to go out a lot of my own spot where the enemy was coming, all this. A lot of camouflage, obviously. My commanding officer, who was a Mustang. Do you know what a Mustang is?
Go ahead.
That's an enlisted man promoted to officer for the duration of the war. He had been a sergeant in Guadalcanal. No, he'd been a private in Guadalcanal. Then a sergeant in Korea. Then a gunny sergeant in Vietnam. Three tours. And then he was named first lieutenant for taking over our company. The guy taught me a lot. He knew everything. He's from Springfield, too. And he and I got along real well. Took me about a week before he decided to make me company scout. He said, Bill, you're smarter than some of the officers. You know, you ought to read the maps and the plot plans and everything. I told him why he wasn't an officer. He said, what if I offer you this? We're going to send you back to the rear to language school to learn Vietnamese. Then you'll be a POW officer, and you'll be a second lieutenant. He said, let me, you know, write my father. He said, no, you got to decide. I said, my father's cancer's been pretty good lately. I'll do it. I got shot in the last patrol. I was going back to the rear first to go from my R&R, and I was going to, I picked Australia. They love Marines in Australia. The girls do. That's all I had to know. Because Australia and New Zealand during World War II, the Australian troops were in South Africa, or North Africa. The Marines basically guarded the people there. And both those island countries love it.
So let's get back to when you were shot.
I got shot and bayoneted at the same time. got shot in the right arm, and you could see the scar. And I got bayoneted in the face. The enemy had 15-inch bayonets. We had 5-inch K-bars. That's what we called our bayonet. When the reason I got shot, it was monsoon weather. And I don't know if you've been in a monsoon, but it's like a fire hose is on you. It's brutal. And it was slogging along in the mud on a not that high a mountain, but in the Benar River's beneath us, where the enemy crossing. We had three patrols out that morning. All three were in combat at furious distances. We were a 9-man patrol, I think. We spotted the enemy coming across the river. We opened up on them. Unfortunately for us, the enemy had about 20 troops in elephant grass behind us. Elephant grass is razor sharp, and they call it elephant grass because it's maybe 20 feet tall, and it's grass. And it's like razor blades. And they charged us. I was the first man up, obviously, because I was point man on that particular patrol. They shot me in the arm. He was probably going for my head, but I happened to slip at the same time he shot me. I fell down. A second one came to finish me off with his bayonet. My guys had dived in the shell holes because they were fighting troops below them and behind them. Two of them came running at me. The guy shot me and the other one to bayonet me. And I'm here, they're not. I shot one in the stomach with my rifle, using my left hand, obviously. And because the right hand, you know, blew the whole tricep muscle out on 7 inches of bone. And the second one, the bayonet me, stood over me with bayonet and bent down to finish me off. I moved my head and I took my bayonet out of my side, which was here, and got him in the throat. He fell dead on top of me. But that's being a Marine for you.
All right, so you're wounded, you took out two of the enemy. Were you taken to an aid station afterward?
Well, the corpsman who had only gone in the patrol, because it's going to be my last one for, you know, a couple of months, he was, in fact, he was in my wedding party later, Tom Hansen. And Tom Hellman Hannon was saying, yeah, he was from, see, it could have been Natick down there, I think of it. He's from that area. And Tom gave me a couple of shots of morphine and didn't stop the bleeding, but bandaged it because I was bleeding in both the head and the arm. The arm was worse, so. He told me later, the hole was so big he could have put a softball in there. It's huge. Immediately, they radioed for a job to take me to the rear because I was badly wounded. They put me in to get me the job, but they had to pass me over the mountain top. Like, all I could see below me was ground in the river. They passed me out. Well, the helicopter was USMC number 13. I said to the pilot, because I could still talk, I said, I didn't know the Marine Corps had any 13 choppers. He said, we're the only one. When they put my head on a huge plastic water bottle or water container or something, the enemy firing from across the river with a 50 caliber bullet went right through the helicopter, hit the bag below my head, and my head went on the metal. But that was close. 50 cal's like that big. And you don't want to have nothing to do with those. Then they took me to an underground hospital at Stutt, the Intergriff Combat Base. And a doctor from Newton operated on me. And he said to me, "You probably won't remember this, but I'm from Newton." I'll remember it, you know. He said, "Sure, if you had morphine and more morphine." And next day he came by, he said, "How you doing, Marine?" I said, "Fine, doctor from Newton." He couldn't believe I remembered that. And the next day, my CO came with a general, and they pinned medals on my pillow, which was like, I like that. One was the Purple Heart, obviously, and one was a combat medal.
How long were you in the hospital?
Well, that happened on May 29th, 1969. I landed in country, I think, January 1st, 69. So about 6 months. I went 3 days at Coventry Hospital there in the rear, and then to Japan for one night at a naval hospital. Then from there for a month at Guam Naval Hospital. I was on the beautiful island of Guam, and I couldn't leave the bed because they had a metal pole through my arm. And I couldn't move the arm. And I got to meet the Miss Universe contestant, and there were a lot of nice people there. Mm-hmm. And in fact, she was a college girl that with Guam as a U.S. possession, they get to go to college in the United States for free. And she went to University of San Francisco. But a nice person. And then I met a retired couple from Newton that had been in the Navy, and they basically came to visit you in the hospital all the time. Very nice people. I had a good time there.
Okay.
Well, good time, other than I could just look out the window.
Right. And what happened after Guam?
Okay, we landed first at, they flew me from Guam to Anchorage, Alaska, where they had flight nurses, but in Anchorage they had a doctor come on board, basically because my stomach was like expanding from gases. I was in pretty rough shape. But he flew with us to East St. Louis, Illinois, where they had another air base. We stayed overnight there, then to Bedford Air Base. And now they wouldn't let me take a side trip to Lexington. Again, I was in a stretch the whole time. I went from Bedford to Chelsea Naval Yard, landing there on, I believe, the 4th of July.
Really?
Yeah.
And how long were you in Chelsea?
Till December 31st, 1969.
After which?
After which, the VA, or the Marine Corps, they have to take a series of tests when you leave. And they took my tests. They said, "You're going to be our first one we're going to send to Glasgow." And they paid my way through Glasgow, paid for the books, and gave me a small amount of money to live on.
Were you formally discharged from the Marines at this point?
Yep.
You were, okay.
But they still, the Marines always take care of their own.
Uh-huh. And where did you go to law school?
Suffolk University Law School in Boston.
And what kind of law did you specialize in?
Basically, real estate law, insurance law, and a good amount of tort cases. Do you know the tort cases?
My father was a lawyer, too.
Oh, civil law.
Mm-hmm.
Where I was always on law enforcement type programs and taught law enforcement in Northeastern once I became an attorney. And I taught law there, too. I've never, ever, nor would I, defend a criminal defendant.
Now, you were going to school in the Boston area during the height of the anti-war protests. Any thoughts on that?
Well, obviously, it wasn't that. When I taught at Northeastern, a student, and it was a law class, I believe, said to me, "You were a baby killer, weren't you?" And I said, I never saw a baby. But I said, I never killed a civilian, but I'd kill a communist any time I ran into him. Again, this look, kid never returned to class.
Now, Bill, when the Vietnam War finally ended and
In 75,
and the soldiers were coming back.
One thing you should know about that,
mm-hmm.
You remember the photographs of the Marines on the roof of the embassy?
Yes.
That was my old unit.
Really? 2-4.
They were on a ship out at sea. They were called in because they needed more men there. It was a... The last 10 Marines in Vietnam were from 2-4. And another thing you might not know about Vietnam, the first troop killed, Marine killed, was from Woburn, Mass. The last Marine killed was from Woburn, Mass.
Talk about going full circle.
Yeah.
Wow. So, you know that Vietnam veterans always felt slighted by the treatment they received when they got out. Any thoughts on that, Bill?
Yeah, the politicians were bad friends. A lot of them, I can truthfully say I never did anything illegal over there. And we were told if you do anything illegal, you'll end up in Portsmouth. Portsmouth was the naval brig where they sent Marines and Navy screwed up. The discipline of the Corps was a lot different than like the Army in my life. There's no officer would have told you to shoot civilians. And everything was, you know, when people would give you some crap, "Hey, what service were you in?" I'd say, "I'm proud to say I was a Marine." "Yeah, the biggest baby kill." "I don't care what you say. I never killed a baby, but give me a chance, maybe. We'll have some action." They didn't like that.
Mm. Now, Bill, after you were discharged from the Marines, did you join any veterans organizations?
Yes, I did. I'm a member of the American Legion, the DAV, and the Marine Corps League.
And did you receive any other medals besides the Purple Heart and...
Yeah, I received like 10 medals. I don't remember them all, to be honest. I mean... my unit got and I was in the year when I got it, a presidential unit citation, mm-hmm. which is a high medal. But we're a good unit.
Now, looking back over the past 40 or almost now 50 years, do you think Vietnam veterans are getting better treatment?
Yes.
We're getting close to the end of the interview. Is there anything you would like to say about the Marine Corps in general, your experiences?
I love the Marine Corps. I celebrate their birthday November 10th every year. I've gone to Marine Corps parties. Not while I've been here, of course. The Corps has really helped me be a good attorney, disciplined and honest. And as a Marine, you always try to do the best to help other Marines, help other people for the Corps. When I do my crunches in the gym, or in the pool, in Boston, West Roxbury, I did 130 the other day, but I always do one more for the Corps. They always teach you that. And I'm tired as can be. One for the Corps. So yes, and being a Marine, having met other Marines, you know, in civilian life, boy, there is something to be said for that. They'll do anything for you, really. Marine or Marine, what can we do for you?
Mm-hmm. And Bill, is there anything else?
Yes, Semper Fi. You know what Semper Fi means?
Oh, definitely. I have two nephews in the Marine Corps.
Always faithful mm-hmm. to the Corps.
All right. Well, Bill McCarthy, we thank you so much for taking part in the Natick Veterans Oral History Project.
Thank you very much.